Well, Merry Christmas to you all from us here at TV 44. This week, during the regularly scheduled Faith and Friends times, we bring you part two of Memories of Ron Mile.
From the Sunday school song to his creative telethon sets and so much more, Ron Mile's vision was truly a gift to this region and beyond. We hope you enjoy this opportunity to reconnect with past TV 44 family members like Ginger Stocky and relive some of the wonderful ways Ron Mile made such a difference.
I told their chief engineer, who happened to be a Christian, what we were up to. And I said, we've got a rotating stage in mind, and we can just have that portion already lit. And when we're going to change, divide it into thirds, we wanted to change programs, we just give it a spin, and the lighting is all there. Well, truth is, it wasn't, but we thought. And I explained it to him, and he says, Ron, that sounds like a great idea. He did. He said that. Boy, I wish he hadn't. And we had all kinds of gimmicks. I remember a timer we had. There's something special going to happen in the next 8 minutes. And I'd taken a stovetop timer, and I mounted it behind this board. And then Barney Steeman's wife, she had painted a great big face. It was maybe 5 feet in diameter. Oh, we were so proud of that. And we'd crank it around, click, 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 click. And, okay, ready, get set, go! And the phones would begin to ring. Oh, those were fun days. Anyone could have done what I did. And that's not being Joe Humble. It's just, I'm the one who went ahead and did it. And that can't, there's not much room for pride in that, except pride in Jesus Christ and what he stands for.
Everyone's so well composed. Forget it, that's over. My name is Ginger Stocky. A lot of you know me as Jennifer, and that's Ron's doing, interestingly enough. Ron was the one who hired me at TV 44 nearly 30 years ago now, which is crazy to think about. And my legal name is Jennifer, but I've always been called Ginger by my parents and everyone. But Ron said, do you go by Jenny? And I said, no, I actually go by Ginger. And he goes, no. He said, I have a daughter named Jennifer. I really like that name. We're going to call you that. And I said, okay. So for 18 years, I'm Jennifer here. And so it's heartwarming to be back and to have people say, hi, Jennifer, because you guys are the only ones who do that. And so being at TV 44 right out of college, you know, right out of the chute, was one of God's greatest gifts to me. And being able to learn from Ron and from so many of you just about vision and passion for the gospel and for using TV in a positive way instead of where TV can so easily go, and for putting Christ first all the time. And it made a huge impact on my life and my family's life and my ministry, my future. And here's the part I was telling you about. I'm just very grateful. And I don't know if Ron knew that. And I think that's wrong of me. Ron needed to know that. And so I want you all to know that. Becky, I want you to know how much I appreciate your prayers and your sacrifice and everything you did and continue to do. And all of you, how much you've meant in my life. And I'm so grateful that God would love us enough to give us each other and to put us together the way that he does. And just thinking of Ron makes me smile. You know, he was just so funny, and we had so many good times. And he was funniest when he wasn't trying to be funny, which, you know, that's something you just gotta love about him. But we had many, many wonderful times. And I'm just blessed to be able to have this opportunity, I think, to share in his life and to thank God for the legacy that God has built through Ron. When I see so many people here, and the way that God, we used to laugh about with Ron's Ron's mad scientist side, that he was making us in the transmitter room with test tubes. You know, he's kind of mixing us up, and we grew up out of the transmitter room. And then we'd go out and do our thing. And now to be able to look at everyone and just what God is doing with that beginning of TV 44 and many other things that Ron has been part of, and just shooing us all out into whatever it may be, to making sure that the gospel's still shared so strongly here and in other places, and all the things that he's done in so many of your lives. So it's awesome to be back and to be able to see that and to reconnect with everyone. So I'm grateful to Ron once again.
You talk about Ron's leadership. Two events in the year that Ron really, really loved were the NRB and the Indianapolis 500. I mean, he was always after press passes for the Indianapolis 500. And at the NRB, the first time we went, I think there were six or seven of us in the TV 44 station wagon. And we slept through the night, took turns sleeping in the back of the station wagon. But Ron loved to show people the NRB. He knew the Washington Sheraton better than the maintenance people that ran the place. But you talk about his leadership. You always knew you were in trouble when Ron said, "You want to have some fun? Follow me." Because you knew that you were going to go someplace you shouldn't be. And Ronald Reagan would come to the NRB. Back in those days, the president still came to the NRB. And Ronald Reagan came 3 or 4 years in a row, and Ron says, "You want to see Ron Reagan?" And I said, I got a meeting, Ron. I got to go someplace else. And he said, no. He knew the catacombs of the Washington Sheraton, and he went down in the bases. They will bring them through the hallway. They'll park the limos back here in this hallway back here. They'll go through the kitchen. They come through this hallway right here. And he says, if we're right here, he'll walk by. I got a meeting, Ron. I got to go. And he did it. And he went down there, and he came back later, and I says, "Well, how was it?" He says, I didn't see him." I said, "Why?" He said, "I was down in the hallway. I could see people coming." He said, "All of a sudden, these two great big Secret Service guys with shoulders about that wide jammed me into a doorway and said, 'Don't move.'" And he said, "I heard these footsteps walk by, and pretty soon," he says, "their shoulders dropped down." He says, "They were gone." I said, "Would you do it?" He said, "In a second, I'll do it again." But Ron was also the champion. I told Becky this earlier, the champion of the grip and grin. You've seen a lot of these pictures out there. Ron has probably more pictures with celebrities than any person I know. So we were at the Indianapolis 500. It was the first year there was an African-American driver. And Ron says, and we could get into the pits with his passes. He only had two passes. He usually took three people. And the person that didn't have the pass, he put in the middle. And he said, "Just follow me and act like you're supposed to be here." And you'd walk through, and the first guy would show the pass, and the last guy would show the pass. The person in the middle, who was my son that time, just walked on through. Well, he says, "You want your picture taken with that driver?" I can't remember his name. I said, "Nah, that's all right, Ron. I'm a shy guy." He says, "Well, when he pulls into the pits, he'll get out of the car. He'll talk to his crew real quick. He says, here's the camera. He says, when I put my hand on his shoulder, he says, 'Click the picture.'" I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah." So he walks up, and this guy gets out of the car, and he's talking to his crew, and the guy doesn't even see Ron. He turns around, and Ron puts his hand on his shoulder, holds his hand out, and naturally the guy's going to go like this, and Ron goes, "Click, take the picture. It's time to take." He's got his picture taken with people from all over the world. Anyway, he was a great leader, but following him around was tough to do. And some of the people that had to really keep him kind of on schedule when he was trying to follow him with the ladies who were his personal assistants. Miriam was the first, of course. She remembers all that. Sylvia Kenev was there. And this next lady will tell you some of the... She had a great time with Ron because he loved the stories. Amy Mock.
Why did I think this was a two Kleenex kind of a thing? I've been looking around all over. Where is the Kleenex box? I am Amy Mock, and the first time that I met Ron was actually when I was just a junior higher, and he came to our church to tell our church about this vision that he had. You know, that's what he did. He went around to churches all over the area and told them about this awesome television station that he was trying to bring. And I remember at that time thinking, wow, that sounds so cool. I was so impressed. And So as a 19-year-old newlywed, I saw that there was a job opening at TV 44, and I'd been a secretary for 1 year for the city schools, and why I thought I could go to TV 44 and actually apply for this job, I don't know. But I went in and I applied thinking there's just no way. I'm 19 years old, you know, interviewed, and then I actually got a call, and he wanted me to come and work for him. I mean, who does that? Who hires a 19-year-old to be their assistant? But as you've heard, Ron, that's what he did. He invested in the lives of young people. And there are a few people in my life that I hold in such high regard as Ron. I found out very quickly that organization was not his strong suit. And if you knew Ron, his mind could do amazing things, but organizing, that just wasn't one of them. And so we sat down one day, and when I got there, he had stacks and stacks of documents. They were underneath his desk, they were beside his desk, they were everywhere you could find, there were documents. And he brought me in and he sat me down across from his desk and he said, "I have a problem." And I said, "You do have a problem." And he said, "I can't file." And I said, "I can see." And he said, "Just do it. Just, I don't know, file this stuff for me." So I got into it, and I remember I was looking for the file for the tower. There was something that I had to file for the tower. I said, "Ron, I know you've got stuff about a tower. I can't find a file that says tower." And he went over to the C's. And I said, why am I looking in the C's? What are you doing? And he said, "Well, it's under John Cahill, because John Cahill was the engineer." I don't know really the thought process, but that's just how his mind worked. And I was so intrigued by how his mind worked. He had a walnut on his desk, and it stayed there for a long time. And one time I said, "What is the walnut? Why do you have a walnut on your desk?" He goes, "Have you ever looked at a walnut?" He said, "Look at how bumpy it is. And did you ever think, how did they get that blue diamond stamp on such a wavy surface?" You know, he had a picture on his wall that was these steps. Do you guys remember the picture on the wall with the weird steps that really went nowhere? And it brought him joy. He loved that picture. And I would hear him tell people that it was a gift from his first wife. He said things like that all the time. You'd have to think, "Your first wife." You know, but he loved to do things like that. And there really wasn't a topic that you could talk about that Ron could not have some kind of knowledge of. And I received my very first, I'm 19 years old, I got my first stock tip from Ron. And you know Ron, I mean, money meant nothing to Ron other than what it could do for the kingdom. And, but he said to me, "You know, if I had money, I really think, I've heard about this new, they're gonna be called cellular phones. And I really think they're going to go. And if I had money, right, you know, I would be investing in these companies that are going to do." And he's explaining to me what the cellular phone is going to be, and it sounded like space age, you know. Boy, if Jeff and I had listened, if we'd had any money at that time. The bottom line was, he was a man who was fascinating, and he was fascinated by the simple. And he was fascinated by the complex, and he was a man of integrity. There was never a time that he would be in an office with a woman with a door shut. He adored his wife. She made him laugh. They had the same, she has the same sense of humor, that he just adored her. You could never talk to Ron where he didn't talk about his children. He loved his children. He was so proud of his children and his grandchildren. What a precious gift my husband and I were given several years back when Ron was in the area. He had come to do, I think, the taping of that we've seen him speaking with John. And he called and he said, "Do you want to go to supper?" And we said, "Oh, you know, absolutely." So we went to Texas Roadhouse and sat there for 4 hours and laughed our heads off. Nothing had changed about Ron. Story after story after story. And one of the fun things was he was going to be going with a log splitter all the way. He'd come to get a log splitter from Dwight Weisner, and he was so excited about taking this log splitter back all the way to Georgia, and he was going to look like a hick, you know, he thought, going back. But even these many years later, nothing had changed. And so grateful for the impact that Ron had on my life. And if he taught me anything, he taught me that we serve a very big God, and that if God is in it, anything is possible. Matt and Becky and Jenny, thank you so much for sharing him with us. Thank you for the financial sacrifices your family made, the time sacrifices your family made. And I look forward to seeing him again very soon.
Oh, my Sunday school pin was too long for my coat, and it hung all the way to the floor. I had not missed a Sunday in 43 years, and next year would have been 44. It began on the morn of the day that I was born, when the cradle roll added my name. And through richer and poorer, through sickness and health, my attendance went on just the same. Here's the good part. 40 years without missing a single service. I guarantee it got to be rather nervous, but it stopped short when I fell and broke my shin, when I tripped on my Sunday school pin.
This has been fun seeing everybody tonight. Man, I've just enjoyed connecting with some of you. I'm looking forward to talking to you further. Yes, my name is Jeff Milslegel, and I know some of you, when you last saw me, I had hair. And the rumor is that I've gained a few pounds too, but we're not going to talk about that. I've been at WLMB since June of 2009, and Bob's right. I think I'm the only person that's worked at both WTLW and WLMB. If you remember Ron's office at TLW, if you remember his office, you walked in on a one wall. I think John alluded to it. You had a bunch of microphones up there. Okay, things that really meant a lot to him, old stuff for radio. Because remember, radio was his first love, and so he had stuff up there about that. And then if you turned on the back wall, it'd be the south wall, he had these pictures, and we've talked about that. A lot of you have talked about the various pictures. And a picture's always meant something to him. There was somebody that meant to him, or some interesting way he was able to get the picture, or commemorated a particular event. I remember one picture that's just Ron by himself. And he's sitting in the chair that the Speaker of the House of Representatives used in the U.S. Capitol. He's sitting in that chair. And I remember saying, Ron, how did you get that? And he says, well, you know, Jeff, yeah. Well, Matt and I, we got in there, and I told Matt, I'm going to go up there and sit on the chair, take the picture real quick, then they're going to kick us out of there. So I'm kind of amazed you guys didn't spend some time as guests of the D.C. police that evening. I don't know how this all works. In John chapter 14, Jesus talks about, I go to prepare a place for you. I don't know how it all works, but indulge me a minute. I just wonder if in Ron's place there's a bunch of pictures. And I mean a slew of pictures. All the people that have come to know the Lord as a result of this man. And all the people like myself that have had my life really changed as a result of the time I spent with Ron. I just wonder what that wall looks like and how awesome that would be. How many pictures is it? Hundreds? Thousands? Tens of thousands? I remember a small picture that was on the south wall of the television station, right outside the kitchen, and it was put there before I started there, and it lasted for quite a number of years, and it was real simple. It was a small little thing. I assume some volunteer made it at one time years ago, and it just said, Acts 4:4, and if you remember Acts, that's the corporate name of WTLW, American Christian Television Services, and it was Acts 4:4. And that verse is really fun because the verse says, "Many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000." That has really stuck with me because I thought that really, really described WTLW. But honestly, I think the number's a little low. I think there's a lot more than that of people that have been touched by him. Three broadcast entities, WTGN, WTLW, and now WLMB. They all exist today. They're all very successful. They all thrive. They're all visionaries in their own areas of influence. And get this. All three of them are still proclaiming the gospel message of Jesus Christ. That's what they do. That's amazing in this day and age, particularly in television, when television stations, Christian TV stations, have just gone dark or have sold or have just changed their formats altogether. And yet, not the two that Ron founded. WTLW, WLMB, and yes, WTGN. Psalm 1 speaks of a man of God and how he will be a tree planted by the water. Some versions refer to that as channels of water. Makes you think it's irrigation ditches or something. But anyhow, it's the idea that the man of God is going to be like that. And it talks about how we will bear fruit and will not wither when the heat comes. Jeremiah talks about that in chapter 17. Says much the same thing. A faithful man is someone who does not fear in a year of the drought and who never ceases to bear fruit. Ron bore an awful lot of fruit, folks. Now, I'll just leave you with this. Ron was tenacious. That's a word I'd use for him, tenacious. A dogged determination to succeed at what God had called him to do. Ezra chapter 7, verse 10 says, Ezra set his heart to study the law of the Lord, to teach it, and to obey it. Ron set his heart to teach this book. And how I pray that I might have that same tenacity and dogged determination to finish the race, as Paul says it, like my friend and my mentor, Ron Mile.
Is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning to you. We long for you. When we see today, in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna. Oh,
finish the day. In your presence, all our fears wash away, wash away.
Thank you for joining us for part two of Memories of Ron Mile. We also want to thank those of you who have recently donated to TV 44 in Ron's memory. Like you, we are still thankful for his vision and recognize that its impact truly remains alive today.
You can rewatch this and part one of Memories of Ron Mile by visiting WTLW.com. As we enter 2015, we want to thank you for your vision and faithfulness to TV 44. You are appreciated.